Welcome to Look Up with Pastor Mike and his wife Linda Sasso of Calvary Chapel of Eagle, a radio ministry designed to assist you in applying God's Word to your everyday life. For the next hour, Pastor Mike and Linda will encourage you with your walk with Christ and help you look up to Jesus. If you need advice on marriage, life challenges, or relationships, call in now. It's time to look up to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Here's Mike and Linda.
Well, hi, folks. That's right. Here is Mike and Linda. We're live in studio right now together, and we're looking forward to our journey through this topic on marriage, divorce, and remarriage. And it's interesting, as I was listening to this intro, and the speaker was saying, if you need advice on marriage, that came up first. Well, there's a reason for that, folks. One of the things, one of our favorite topics to talk about is Christian marriage, and we love to help couples succeed and overcome the things that come up against you in marriage. You know, like I've told you yesterday, the divorce rate among Christians is really not much different than the divorce rate out there in the world, and it should not be so. To me, it shows a picture of a lack of commitment to Christ. Because, folks, I'll tell you again, I'll tell you over and over again, it's all about Jesus, and it's all about your commitment to Him, your walk with Him, your connection to Him. If you're walking with the Lord, if you're walking in the Spirit, and you have the Holy Spirit in you, and you're a Christian with the intention of following Jesus, there is no reason why you should be divorcing your spouse. There's a few exceptions, and we're going to cover that as we talk about divorce, because there are certain biblical reasons, legitimate reasons for divorce. But for the most part, we should be able to overcome these difficulties and rise up and have successful marriages. Overcome the obstacles that are in your way. Anyway, I'm going to go off on a rant right now, but I want to let you know we are live in studio and we'd love to connect with you. And Linda's going to tell you the various ways you could connect with us.
Hello, everybody. Hey, we want to remind you this week we went to a 1 hour long show. So at the top of the hour, we take a 1 minute break for station identification. And then we come back again for a second half hour, picking up right where we left off. So make sure you stay tuned if you can. If you can't, you know, you can go back, listen later, especially Facebook Live. You can go back and watch that one later, okay? Now, why do we like talking about marriage so much? Because we, at one time, were probably voted the least likely to succeed, okay? We've been on the other side, guys. We've been there. We've been to marriage hell, and we're in marriage heaven, basically, right now. The Lord was able to bring us through, and I'll tell you, that is the only thing that brings you through. It was our commitment to Him that strengthened a commitment to each other. But the commitment to Him was the source of everything, okay? And that's why we like talking about this. No matter how bad your marriage is, the Lord can fix it if you got two people willing to do the right thing. That's what we talked about in our whole last series on marriage according to the Bible. Okay. Mm-hmm. It has to be two people willing to do the right thing. And we were willing to do the right thing because of our commitment to Christ. Jesus came first.
That's right.
And He gave us the strength in all of this. So that's why you find us talking. Not that we've had all this study and degrees on marriage psychology, because we're not going to tell you psychology. We're going to tell you what the Bible says, and we're going to tell you real life what goes on. Okay? And we're going to be real with you. That's what we can say. You know, this is our passion, because we've seen what God can do. And we don't want people giving up before payday, you know. Hang in there. Yeah. Hang in there, because the Lord can do it. Now, if you have a spouse that is not willing to do the right thing, then I am very sorry, because you can be as willing to do the right thing 125%, and if they're not, it's going to be really difficult.
Yeah.
It's going to be very, very difficult.
Right.
There's only so much you can do if you don't have the two people. That's why Christian marriages are so important. That's why it's so important to not get married unequally yoked. Oh, man,
and
it goes
we'll
into
talk
everything.
About that too. Yeah. Yeah.
So let me give you those numbers. We would love for you to give us a call. we have time now. We can spend time on the phone with you if you've got time to spend with us. That number to be live on the air with us is 208-377-3790. Again, that is 208-377-3790. Now, speaking live on the radio just makes you freeze in your steps. Go ahead, send a text message to Calvary Chapel Eagles phone, 208-891-2635. I keep an eye on that one, too. I have it here with me. And if you're out there in Facebook Live land, go ahead, leave a comment. We keep an eye on those ones, too, and we try to answer them. So this isn't just me and Mike sitting here. If you're listening to us, you're here with us. So go ahead and participate with us.
There you go. Now, listen, we did cover a number of things yesterday that I'm not going to go over all the scriptures, but I just do want to review the points because I want to keep this together as one piece. We're looking at, first of all, the foundation and purpose for marriage. And so let me just read through those points. We won't go over all the verses again. But number one, God's intention for marriage is that it's to be a sincere and lasting vow of commitment before God, instituting a lifelong union of secure and loving companionship between one man and one woman. We talked about the verses that support that, so I'm going to move on. Next, marriage is intended to be a relationship of love and safety where both the husband and the wife reflect Christ's love to the glory of God. Now, I want to remind you again, a lot of people miss that phrase, Christ's love. Not that you're not supposed to have love for one another, but if you miss the love of God in your marriage, then all you're going to be is fleshy human love that's temporary and short-lived and doesn't last. We need Christ's love, folks, to get through. I mean, my goodness, you need Christ's love to love your kids. you get through life. Our love runs out. Our fuse can be short. God's love is from everlasting to everlasting. And I'm grateful that the Lord gives us his righteousness. He gives us his love. He gives us of his spirit, that we might be able to, partake of the divine nature, and that we are actually having the Spirit of God within us. We can love with the love of God. Yeah. And so that's really important as we look into our next verse. Now, did you have something? I'm looking across the table. Okay. So we left off on, we already covered Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 through 29. And now we've got 1 Peter chapter 3. I've chosen to read this from the New Living Translation. I really, you know what, the more I read the New Living, the more I'm tempted to just use New Living in the pulpit. I mean, I do quote from it a lot, but I think it's a very accurate translation, and it does such a great job of capturing the true meaning of the original text. I think it's scholarly. It's not just like the Living Bible, okay? And it also puts it in words that just really hit the spot. So let me read to you from the New Living. And this covers a lot because, remember, the statement I just read was that marriage was intended to be a relationship of love and safety where both husband and wife reflect Christ's love to the glory of God. And I think this text reveals what that should look like, okay? So, New Living Translation, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. In the same way, you wives must accept the authority of your husbands. Then, even if some refuse to obey the good news, your godly lives will speak to them without words. They will be won over. Now, I do want to comment as I go along here, because this is talking about maybe a wife that got saved and the husband wasn't saved yet. We're going to talk about being unequally yoked in a few points down the line here, that if you can choose wisely before you get married, you don't marry an unbeliever. But I think this is addressing a Christian woman who got saved after she got married.
That's what I was thinking.
And now she's, they were both unsaved. Now she's saved. What do? Do you nag your husband into the kingdom? You can't nag your husband into the kingdom.
Talk to me.
That will not help, okay? What you want to do is, it says that you wives must accept the authority of your husbands. Then even if some refuse to obey the good news, your godly lives will speak to them without any words, and they'll be won over. So, wives, if there's some women out there, Christian gals, who are listening to me, and you are married to a non-Christian man, Peter's advice to you is, you don't just ignore his authority because he's not a Christian. I'll only submit to him if he's a godly man. Well, you're blowing it, girl. You need to show respect to your husband. You need to recognize his authority in the home. And even though he's not maybe under God's authority, he's still the head of the home. God puts him as head of the home. His responsibility is that way. And you need to treat him as such.
Christian or non-Christian, men need respect. Okay? We went over that before. We were covering the marriage part of it. But men will thrive when they are shown respect. If they're a halfway decent guy. If they're a total jerk, then okay. No, then it can become abusive. Okay, we understand that. But with most normal men, they need respect. And they want respect in the home. Because they may not get it any other place. If they're not the boss at work, they may be low on the totem pole, and they may not be getting respect at all. Matter of fact, they may be shredded at work. At home may be the only place that some men get respect, and they need it. Women, if you give them the respect, you build them up, it will make a difference in them. And if you have a non-Christian husband, he may ask you, why do you do this?
Mm-hmm.
And you say, because of the love of Jesus. You know, now when I did that for my husband, he knew exactly why. He knew it was Christ through me, okay? But if that's what this is saying here, maybe you could even win them over because you're showing Christ's love and you're showing the respect that he needs.
Yeah. You know, Linda, as I look at this text in 1 Peter chapter 3, what jumps off the page to me right now is in verse 1, it actually says that, you know, your godly life shall speak to them without any words. I think sometimes we can ruin things with our words. You know, sometimes it's better not to try to witness with words. I know there's that one saying that really gets on my nerves. I think it's of St. Francis of Assisi. He says, preach the gospel to every creature and when necessary, use words. I get what he's trying to say, but that I don't like that saying because I think it's always necessary. Nobody gets saved without hearing the words of the gospel. You don't just get saved by watching somebody's good behavior.
Yeah.
But what this is talking about in a marriage situation, that an ungodly man, he notices something's different about you, girl. I mean, especially if he's married you when you were not a Christian, and now you're a Christian, and you're acting different, your priorities are different, your integrity is through the roof, and this man is going to notice there's something different about you. You don't have to preach at him, okay? So, as a matter of fact, that's one of the things. Every now and then we'll get email questions or texts, a backside of Facebook and so on, that people want advice how to win over their unsaved relatives or friends. And many times we'll just tell them to bite your tongue and love them, you know, because it's a big mistake that people make is that you badger somebody with your words and you actually could push them away. And so you don't want to beat them up with your words. You want to love them first and foremost. So it says that you could speak to them without words. There's an interesting saying, speak to them without words. Okay. Then let me finish. I actually stopped.
I don't think we could do that on the radio.
No. Okay.
Nah.
Can you see it? Okay, no, we won't try that. All right, so it says, they will be won over, and I stopped there on verse 1, but actually, there's no comma or period there. It goes on to verse 2. They will be won over by observing your pure and reverent lives. Now, you may think, and sometimes it's true, that a husband gets upset when a woman starts getting a little godly and prissy, and I don't do that anymore because if a guy likes to party and do crazy things, especially if he wants to do unbiblical things, and the wife all of a sudden doesn't want to party like that anymore, that could cause trouble. But for the most part, overall, I believe that Peter's right here, that a non-Christian man is going to notice the difference in his wife, and she doesn't have to preach to him. She'll notice that there's something different. There's something pure. There's something godly, that she's reverencing the Lord. And everything she does, it's because of her love for God. And it makes the Lord real. It makes God real. And I'll tell you something, there's a difference between religion and Christianity. Because religion could just be a dead religion of just a bunch of rules, and you just think, what is wrong with you? You're dead. But when you see somebody excited about, you know, if someone loves the Lord, when you love someone, they're alive, they're bubbling over, because when you're in love, it just changes everything about you. And so when a husband sees that his wife loves the Lord, it's going to make all the difference in the world. Okay, so.
And, I went back to the Strong's here, and it says that you may be won by the conduct of their wives when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. Now, that observe means to, come on, bring it back up, to inspect. Ladies, when your life changes, these guys are watching. They're like, it's not just, whatever. No, they're like, what just happened here?
Yeah, right.
Who are you? Yeah. Where'd my wife go? You know, type thing. It means to be an overseer, to look upon, to view attentively. It means that by your submission to them still, even if they don't obey the Lord, you could win them over because they're just watching you. It's like, and they could be watching you in, okay, if I throw this out at her, if I irritate her a little, let's see what she's going to do. Do you know what I mean? You got husbands like that. You know them. And if you can handle this correctly with keeping the respect for them, it's really going to make them wonder, what is going on here? Who is this person? That's
right.
A good thing. And it will. It'll get their attention. When somebody changes, something happens in their life and they change, people kind of stop and take a second look and like, what is going on here? You know, I would say since the death of our daughter, people have stopped and taken a look. Okay, wait, how are they handling this? What do you mean they're still going back on the radio show? What do you mean they keep going back to the pulpit? They didn't take 6 months, a year off or anything. They kept going. What is this? Well, it changed us. It changed us. It made us different. Made priorities, I think, different.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate to say, my tolerance for stupid things, I don't have anymore. I really don't. When people are playing petty little games, I have no tolerance for that anymore. There's too many important things in life.
Right.
Okay?
Life is short.
Yeah, life is short. Don't play stupid games, okay? With your spouse, with your children, with anyone. Get down to what's really serious in life, okay? There, right. Side note, somebody needed to hear that.
Absolutely,
one today,
absolutely. So. Now, the next statement here in Scripture can be misunderstood. As a matter of fact, I think it's been abused over the years in different denominations. And, of course, you may not recognize it because I'm reading from the New Living Translation. But 1 Peter 3:3 says, don't be concerned about outward beauty of fancy hairstyles, expensive jewelry, or beautiful clothes. You should clothe yourself instead with the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God. Now, let's make sure, let's take a big picture here. What is this about? It's talking about the emphasis of your life, gals. And it's not talking about, as a matter of fact, in some translations, it makes it sound like you shouldn't wear nice clothing and you shouldn't wear, let's look at the old King James, because that one could be really misunderstood here. King James says, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and wearing gold and putting on of apparel, but let it be of the hidden man of the heart. Now, that's King James, but some of these staunch, hardcore, legalistic churches would take this to say that women should not wear jewelry, women should not wear makeup, women should only wear dresses down to their ankle.
Yeah, but it said putting on apparel. Maybe they don't want you to wear any clothes.
That's right. I was going to make that point. Because really, if you're not supposed to be adorning yourself with a plaiting of the hair and wearing gold, it also says of putting on apparel. Does that mean you're not supposed to put on apparel? Stop and think about what it's really saying. What Peter is saying is the emphasis of your life should not just be Glamour magazine and trying to win a beauty contest. It's nice that you're pretty. You know, guys like it when you're pretty. That's nice. We don't want our women to be ugly, okay? But it's talking about the real beauty that God wants you to have is that inner hidden beauty, that beauty of the heart. It says, verse 4 says, you should clothe yourself instead with the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious to God. Let me stop there and make point out a couple words here. Gentle and quiet spirit. Boy, I tell you something. I've seen gals who look really nice, they'll turn your head when they walk into the room, but they open their mouth and it's like, oh my goodness, stay away from her, okay? But what God wants you women to have is a gentle and quiet spirit, that you're not offensive, you're not rash or brash, you're not someone who's vulgar. It's funny, I remember when I was young and single, there were times when every now and then a girl would catch my eye. I'd think, man, she's pretty. And then she'd open up her mouth, and I'd hear the foul language coming out of her mouth, and she'd light up a cigarette and blow it out. And I'm thinking, you know, everything about her was like, that's my opinion of her just changed. You know, so I like that Peter emphasizes what's important to God is your gentle spirit, your quiet spirit, the beauty that comes from within. And so anyway, I don't know if some of our listeners are in one of those churches that make a big deal that you're not supposed to fix your hair or wear makeup. I like what J. Vernon McGee used to say. You know, he'd always say, well, if the barn needs painting, paint it. I like that because he was an old school guy. You know, I mean, back in those days when I first started listening to him is when there was the Jesus movement, and he was a little critical of electric guitars in church, you know, and stuff like that. And yet he got this, that he would always say, if the barn needs painting, paint it. So, gals, wives, look good for your husband. That's important. It's not talking about not looking nice and not putting on makeup. A little story I should confess is I used to always tell my wife when I first married her that you're beautiful. You don't need makeup. Stop wearing the makeup. You know, you're just beautiful, natural beauty, you know. And every now and then I would just say to her, wow, you look pretty today. And she'd kind of grin from ear to ear. And she'd go, yeah, I'm wearing makeup.
Yeah, I tested it. I put it to the test.
She'd catch me off guard. It's like, oh, but the makeup makes you look a little prettier there. So anyway.
When the barn gets older, it needs even more paint. Okay. And it's so funny. You talk about, you know, the hair and everything, adorning the hair. I'm sorry. That's one thing that goes. Mine is gray. What can you do? You get older, it starts thinning. You do the best.
Your hair is gray. I thought that you went to the beauty shop and had it done like that.
Oh, yes. Oh, no. Excuse me. Mine is silver instead of gray.
Looks like you paid a lot of money to get it to look like
that. So, silver. Okay. And then I got rings that are gold. Okay. I do have a couple fine, you know, things that way.
You're breaking the commandment all over the place.
I know. But when it talks about the putting on fine apparel, it's really funny because I was bragging to my mom about my $1 shirt I got at Walmart the other day. So, not fine apparel on this body. But what it's talking about is, who are you inside? We can do whatever we want to the outside and make ourselves look better, make ourselves look attractive. But are we full of dead man's bones? Mm. Are we full of rot and filth? And, you know, I think of the current political situation. Ugh, when some of these women open their mouths and the things that come out of them, it's like, I don't know how they can do that. I'm embarrassed just hearing it. I turn it off. I won't even listen. But to be the one speaking that and to be so crude and crash, I don't get it. I really don't. It's not attractive. I wish they knew that wasn't attractive. But, you know, what it is what's on the heart, what's in the heart on the inside, it's going to come out in your behavior. And if that behavior is gentle, a quiet spirit, it's going to come forth. You know, that's not our human nature. That's not our flesh. Our flesh is to be rude and to just be disgusting. Okay. That has to be the Spirit of God within us that makes a difference in our hearts. What's in your heart will eventually come out. You know, we talked about this before. Anybody can put on a good act for a certain amount of time. But push one of their buttons and you're going to see what they're made of. Mm-hmm. One thing that Mike and I have always said, you never really know anybody until you've offended them. Okay? Then you see what they're really made of. Some take their toys and go home, and others sit there and say, wait a minute, what did you mean by that? I think I'm offended. And you straighten it out. And if you offended somebody and you fix it, you've worked on it, you've cared enough, you've loved enough to do that, it makes a stronger bond than you've ever had before, right? You know? So what's in your heart does come out eventually. It will come out. Can only put on an act for so long. We only keep our makeup on until we go to bed at night, and then the real person comes through, you know. But it's what's inside that matters, and that's the part I want to fix. That's the part that doesn't decay. That's mm-hmm. the part that doesn't get old. That's the part that doesn't keep needing a paint job on it, okay? If you work on that heart of Christ in you, you don't need your barn painted. Jesus' barn stays painted. It looks brand new, like one of those vinyl fences that are up now, you know? Compared to those old wood ones that look terrible. Bringing this up, we got a thing with our community right now. So it's like those vinyl fences. Oh, man. They look nice almost everywhere you look at them if somebody put them up right, huh? They stay that way. So keep that picture in mind.
Yeah, okay. There's a whole long story behind that. I'm not even going to address right now. Okay, listen, I know we're supposed to be talking about marriage, but I hope that you recognize that God's speaking to some of you, especially the gals out there right now, and we're going to be talking to the husbands next in this text. But I hope you recognize that God's word always has something relevant and important and timely to say to us. And so as we're looking at this topic of marriage, divorce, and remarriage, we're going to focus, first of all, on the priorities of marriage, the focus of marriage, the reason why we have marriage. But in it, you want to know what's a wife supposed to be like, what's a husband supposed to be like. It goes on to say in 1 Peter chapter 3, New Living Translation, verse 5, this is how the holy women of old made themselves beautiful. They trusted God and accepted the authority of their husbands. Nowadays, that could be really pushed back against, okay? Because, all right, I trust God, but I don't want to trust the authority of my husband. Well, I'm telling you, this is God's plan. We've already talked about this, 1 Corinthians 11:3. Look it up. We've already talked about God's order for the family. There's a headship in the Trinity. There's a headship in the home. And so it's important to recognize that. And just, I think that all of the Christian life is really about submission. It's about submission to God. It's about reaping the benefits of a life yielded to God. And within that, there's submission in the home.
Oh, it's all about we give up our rights?
Well, that's...
We die to ourselves? Yeah. That's the Christian life. We die to ourselves. And let me tell you, for those of you that are hanging on so tight, no, this is my life. I want to enjoy it. I want to do what I want to do. When you finally die to yourself, give up your rights, give up your wants, your dreams, your desires, you find out you are in the best and freest place you've ever been. It's actually bondage when you try to hang on to what you would think is freedom. Dying to yourself, you know, it's just, then you can actually let Jesus do and be what he wants to be in your life.
Yeah, amen. Okay, let's see if we get through the scripture before our station break here. It's talking about the holy women of old and how their goal was to make themselves beautiful before God and also to accept the authority of their husband. It says an example in verse 6. For instance, Sarah obeyed her husband, Abraham, and called him master. You are her daughters when you do what is right without the fear of what your husband might do. And so part of your trusting the Lord, gals, if you're married, part of your trusting the Lord is learning how to be a quiet and a gentle spirit to your husband and not always bucking the system. Now, yes, if you see him headed for trouble, I think it's important to speak up and say, honey, be careful because we could get in debt if we do that. We may not be able to pay that bill. Or, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with being wisdom to your husband. My wife, I lean on her for wisdom. She catches things I may not catch, okay? But there comes a point, ultimately, it's my decision. There's times, even recently with church decisions, she's giving me her opinion, and I'm thinking, that's nice, honey, but I don't want to move the church out of Eagle. there's things we deal with that there's times the husband just has to make the decision, be the head of the home. But guys, always listen to your wife. And wives, don't be afraid to speak up if your husband is headed for trouble. Now, we're going to have a station break. We'll continue here in a moment.
All the broken pieces that you hold, turn them over, give them up, and then watch what Jesus does.
You're listening to 94.1 The Voice, KBXL, Caldwell, Boise, radio you can believe in. Stay tuned. Mike and Linda will be right back. Look Up was recently extended to a full hour from 2:30 to 3:30 every Monday through Friday. Mike and Linda want to help you apply God's Word to your everyday life. Through Facebook Live, text, and phone, you can ask questions on what the Bible has to say about the real things that are going on in your life. To access the Facebook Live feed, be sure to send a friend request to Linda Bennett Sasso. If you would like to text the Sassos, the number is 208-891-2635. The best way to have your question answered is to call the Sassos in the studio right now. That number is 208-377-3790. That's 377-3790. To learn more about Calvary Chapel Eagle, visit calvarychapeleagle.com. Now, here's Mike and Linda.
All right, that wasn't so painful, huh? Sometimes we need to, when we stop.
That's what I was just going to say.
Yeah, we've been married too long. Now let's just keep doing it, though. Okay, listen, we're continuing in 1 Peter chapter 3, and I am reading from the New Living Translation. And so let's look now. It actually tells you, you know, we talked enough about the wives and their quiet and submissive spirit. But let's talk to the husbands, because that's where Peter goes next in verse 7.
Does that mean I don't have to call you master? Master.
Okay. So Peter says, in the same way, you husbands must give honor to your wives. Treat your wife with understanding as you live together. She may be weaker than you are, but she is your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Treat her as you should, so your prayers will not be hindered. You know, what I really like about the New Living here is, if you study this in some of the other translations, even from the King James to even some of the modern translations, you might have to explain it a little bit more, but the New Living explains it, okay? The New Living pretty much says it like it is. So, in the same way, you husbands must give honor to your wives. Now, isn't that interesting that the Bible, or Peter himself, Apostle Peter, would tell the husbands to honor their wives? Usually it goes the other way. People like to emphasize wives honoring their husbands. But how do you honor her? It says, treat her with understanding as you live together. You know, now there's a big mystery. I've heard a lot of jokes about that. How do you understand your wife? You know, the thing is, you've got to be understanding. If you want to have a successful marriage, if you want your marriage to be victorious in Christ, guys, you need to be understanding towards your wife. You can't just use the "because I said so" line like you do with your kids. And by the way, I don't think that's the best way to deal with your kids either.
No.
So what you want to do is seek to understand her. If there's a disagreement, if there's headbutt or tug of war going on, make sure that you give her airtime. You know, ask her some questions and say, what's the problem with this? Why don't you agree with this? Let her talk. And when she talks, listen, okay? Unfortunately, too many times when our wives talk, we're not listening. So listen, treat your wives with understanding as you live together. She may be weaker than you are, but she is your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Now, I love that, because a lot of people think it's brawn overcomes brains or something. The important thing is that you will love your wife. And it doesn't matter who's tougher. You know, it's not the one with the most guns wins. You know, that's how the world thinks. You need to realize she's a weaker vessel, and you need to treat her as precious and be understanding towards her, and treat her as an equal. I don't care what translation you read this in, guys, but in 1 Peter 3:7, look it up in your favorite Bible. It's going to tell you to treat your wife with honor and understand her, and to treat her as equal, because you're partners. You know, your partners in this gift of new life. It says, it goes on to say, treat her as you should, so your prayers will not be hindered. There's something a lot of guys might miss. I really believe that one of the causes of unanswered prayer is, at least in men's lives, is the way they treat their wives. There's been times throughout the years that the Lord has kind of nudged me and says, you know, when I'm complaining about something, how come you don't answer me? How come you don't do this? How come? And I feel like the Lord is saying, well, because your relationship with me is a reflection of your relationship with the with your wife. The way you treat your wife is going to affect the way I'm going to treat you. It's like, okay. I mean, the Lord's really got my attention with that a couple times. Let me read that last line again. Treat her as you should so your prayers will not be hindered. Guys, I really believe that you will have a much more effective prayer life if you treat your wife in a loving, tender, understanding way, honoring her, treating her as partners in this gift of life that we have together, as 1 Peter 3:7 says. Now, I was going to end there, but, Linda's got something here. Yeah, go ahead.
Don't leave me out, okay, when you're talking about dwell with them with understanding, okay? You got to let the woman talk here a little bit. Men, if there's any men out there listening, or you're going to be listening to this later, you've got to understand. You have to have knowledge. It doesn't mean that, you fully understand a woman. Women don't understand women, okay? So don't feel bad about that one, okay? Don't feel bad. Women don't always understand women either here. But you've got to find out the knowledge of what makes her tick and why. You don't know, or if you don't know, her background, you need to find out. Let me tell you, there's so many times that there's a marriage problem, and one of the things has been, this woman had abuse as a child. That's going to affect a marriage. That's going to carry over, and especially if she hasn't been able to talk to anybody about it and deal with it, because there's usually guilt. I mean, just the mess it can end up making. You need to know that. Men, you need to know. You need to ask those questions. You need to find out about their past. You need to find out, was there a good childhood, a bad childhood? Did bad things happen that someone shouldn't have to go through, that it's baggage they carry into their adult lives, even as a Christian? Many Christian women, Christian men, carry baggage into their lives mm-hmm. from what happened to them when they were young, okay? You got to know this. If you know that, then you understand what you're dealing with, and you understand how to deal with it. Find out how. How can you be a comfort? One thing is to talk them through it. If they've never been able to talk to someone before, talk with them about it. Let them express the pain and finally let it out, because they may have never been able to do that their whole lives. So, men, when it talks about understanding, you need to find out the facts so that you know what you're dealing with here. It will help you so much. And then having that compassionate heart, especially if your wife's gone through something horrific in her childhood, you better believe she's a weaker vessel. Mm-hmm. She's going to be broken. We agree, Mike and I agree, we're all broken.
Yeah.
One way or another, we're
right.
broken.
That's
Some
right.
are broken more than others, but all of us have our parts that are broken, okay? And that's where, you know, we need to understand each other. And anyone's broken. And woman, if your husband went through some kind of an abuse, he's broken. Maybe he's weaker in that way. And you need to just be there for each other, not judging, not condemning. You need to be there loving, supporting, understanding, giving them a safe place to talk about this. And one more time, Mike, I really feel that's for somebody.
Yeah.
They needed to hear that today. And if you are a wife or a husband and you have not talked to your spouse about something horrific that you went through, talk to them now. That could be the wall between you that's separating you. Be vulnerable. That's kind of, they were naked and not ashamed.
Right.
They were
right.
vulnerable to each other. They didn't tease, make fun of, bring guilt on. They loved each other.
Right.
Okay.
And let me clarify something. I know, hon, you said a moment ago that husbands need to talk to their wives. But as a man, let me clarify something for you guys. It's more listening than talking. because you could do more harm. Remember, a wife was told earlier in 1 Peter 3 that you win them over without words. In the same way, guys, you don't fix your wife by talking to her. I think that's one of the big mistakes that men make, is that when your wife is going through a problem, or she's hurting and she's emotional, that you want to lecture her, or you want to give her a verse, or you want to tell her snap out of it, or you want to talk to her, stop. I think talking to her, the best way you could talk to your wife in an understanding way is ask her a couple questions and let her talk. Listen. Because, guys, I promise you, there's things about your wife you don't know. There's things about your woman that's different than every other woman out there, and you haven't got a clue, because that's the nature of man. We are clueless in so many ways. Women are very emotional. Men are very logical. And that's why Linda says sometimes women don't understand women, because there's not always a logic to it. Sometimes it's just electricity. It's emotional electricity. And I'm not saying it in a belittling way. We're just wired differently. And so I want to let you know, guys, you want to live with your wife in an understanding way and honor her, and treat her as an equal. That means you ask a couple questions, honey. Ask her a few questions and then let her talk, and you listen. The best thing you can do is listen to your wife.
Men, if you don't know this, usually when a woman wants to talk about something, they really don't want your opinion. They just want to talk and get it out. I don't know if men are this way, but so many times when I verbally say something that I might be going through dealing with, when I say it out loud and I hear it, all of a sudden it makes more sense to me, or I already have my answer then. It was so bottled up, I wasn't able to see it clearly. And trying to explain it to somebody else, then it was like, oh, wow, that just made so much more sense. And Mike may not have even said a word. And I said, thank you, honey. That was really helpful.
Yes, you're welcome.
You know, that can happen. You know, one thing else that I do want to point out here, after we're talking about that, the you know, submitting, calling him Lord and all of this stuff, at the end of that scripture, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, one isn't better than the other. Mm-hmm. It's just the authority structure mm-hmm. that God has set forth, okay? So we're heirs together. We're equal in our portion in heaven. That's how the Lord sees
us. That's right.
But he set up an authority structure here on earth so things run smoothly, just like those traffic lights help things run smoothly. Have you ever been on the road when the traffic lights are out? Oh, chaos, absolute chaos. So authority structure is set up for you, but we're co-heirs together of the grace of life. What a precious promise that is. But the men are told they have to be kind to their woman, or their prayers aren't going to get answered. Okay? There's times you feel like your prayers are bouncing off the ceiling. Well, maybe you better take a look at how you guys have been treating each other.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay, now, again, some of you may be saying, well, wait a second here. I thought you were talking about marriage, divorce, remarriage. Give me the facts. Wait a second. We're talking about marriage, divorce, remarriage, but first we're talking about marriage. We've got to lay this foundation. And remember, the point that we're supporting with these verses we're looking at is this. Marriage is intended to be a relationship of love and safety where both the husband and wife reflect Christ's love to the glory of God. And I think that's what all these scriptures that we're looking at say. Now, I originally in my notes, I told you I'm refining a paper I wrote probably 10 years ago about marriage, divorce, and remarriage. Originally, I stopped at verse 7, but I'm realizing as I look at this, this whole context really gives you some principles of life that applies to marriage. And so I'm going to keep reading here, but I think Linda's got something.
I just want to throw something out. I'm keeping an eye on Facebook Live here. And Charmaine put, we don't need to be fixed. We just need to be heard for women.
Yeah,
and that is very, very true. We also have a Nicole that is asking that we pray for her and her husband to get back to Idaho to their family. I guess they're in the UK right now. So should we stop and do that?
Sure.
Okay. Lord, we just lift up Nicole as she's joining us today on Facebook Live. And we pray, Lord, that you would find that way, provide that path that she could get back to her family in Idaho. Lord, we pray your blessings upon her. In your name, Amen.
Amen. All right, listen, I'm going to keep going in this text because I think there's some really key things that, though it says, like verse 8 says, finally, all of you should be of one mind. My goodness, remember we were going through scriptural principles of marriage, and I would say, if this is for how every person should act, every Christian should act, certainly it should also apply to marriage. That's one of these verses. Finally, all of you should be of one mind, sympathize with each other, love each other as brothers and sisters, be tender-hearted, and keep a humble attitude. Now, this is talking about, and again, I'm reading from the New Living. That's why it sounds a little different to you if you're a Bible scholar. But it's talking about how Christians in general should be treating one another. And so, you know, how much more should this apply to our marriages that we need to sympathize with each other, we need to love each other, we need to be tender-hearted and keep a humble attitude.
Tender-hearted. That tenderness, that's one of my favorite words that I will always throw out when we're doing any kind of marriage counseling to the man is tenderness. Women need to be treated tenderly. They're not one of the guys on the construction site. They don't want to be smacked upside the back or punched in the arm, but tenderness, men, will get you so much further than being crude or brash or joking with her or putting her down. Be tender and courteous. Oh my gosh. Courteous is such a, I think we've lost that nowadays. People just aren't courteous. Look at the roads. Oh my gosh, somebody needs to get over in the lane and it's like, no, this is my road, get your car off of it. I mean, you put a turn signal on. It's better here in Idaho than it was in California, but guess who's moving to Idaho? And so you're seeing it more.
Yeah.
You're seeing it more here, where it used to be when we first moved here. You put on a turn signal, somebody would let you over. They were understanding. They were courteous. Now it's like, don't you drive on my road. This is mine. You're not going to get in front of me. Like, that 1 second is going to make such a difference in where they're getting.
And now a turn signal means you better bridge the gap before they get in front of you.
Yeah,
you
know? It is. It's a shame when you see people doing that. So courteous. Oh, my gosh, this generation, we've lost it. How to be tender, how to be courteous. And then we go on, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, a blessing. To bless people, to not, when somebody does something bad to you, oh my gosh, people want to say, yeah, well, I'm going to do this to you now. And in the absolute worst is when that happens in marriage. When that happens in marriage, somebody says something, somebody hurts you, and then all of a sudden, yeah, I'm going to get them back. Well, you have just made a disaster of your marriage if that's the attitude you're going to take. And it isn't going to last very long, okay? We don't repay evil for evil. We try to understand. That's when you need to go talk and say, hey, honey, I was kind of hurt by what you said here. What did you mean by that? And you know what? If they just tell you, hey, bad day, I'm sorry I took it out on you, you can fix it. But don't repay when you're hurt by hurting them back, right?
Right.
That's one of the worst things you can do.
I think all of these things you're describing, all the things we're seeing here in verse 9, is actually a description of the last two words of verse 8. And again, I'm reading from the New Living. It says, keep a humble attitude. I think a humble attitude makes all the difference in the world. If you think you're all that, it's all about you, and this is your road, and this is your life, and don't interfere, and this is my marriage, and it's my rights, and you know what you deserve, that changes the whole complexion of what your marriage will look like, what your life will look like, how people view you. If you keep a humble attitude and realize it's not all about me, it's actually all about the Lord and how I can glorify him in the decisions and the attitudes I hold. And so all of these things, don't repay evil for evil. Don't retaliate with insults when people insult you. Instead, pay them back with a blessing. That's what God has called you to do, and he will bless you for it. As a matter of fact, it's interesting. Just last night, I had a hard time sleeping, and I was, for some reason, my mind was just racing. I was thinking about people that we've had conflicts with in the church over the last year.
Oh, that's usually me, not you.
No, it was me. And there was one brother in particular that kept coming to mind, and I felt like betrayed or hurt by this brother. And it was like, but why? But I was trying to figure it all out. And finally, I just thought, you know what? I need to pray that God blesses him. I need to pray for that brother. And so I actually spent some time. I was laying in bed. I just prayed for the brother. And he has since left the church. And pray that God uses him. He's a gifted guy. The Lord has used him in the past. I just prayed God's blessing upon him because it was messing with my heart. It was preventing me from keeping a humble heart because it's really easy to get bitter and to get, you know, a bad attitude and to hold a grudge. But I'm telling you something, folks, a little tip I learned many years ago is it's hard to have a grudge against somebody that you are praying for
yes.
on a regular basis.
Yes.
It's hard to have a bad attitude towards somebody that you're praying regularly that God will bless their lives. And so that's why Jesus said, you know, that we should bless our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. We need to learn that principle. It will change your life, and it fits here in your marriage as well. You know, you pray for your spouse when if they've offended you, if they've hurt you, if you feel a bit betrayed by something they've done or haven't done. You need to pray for one another. And by the way, I think you need to pray for one another out loud when that's possible. Sometimes yeah. there's a problem in the marriage. And you say, let's pray, and your wife says, go ahead. You know, there's a little different thing here. I'm talking about when you can, lay hands on your wife and pray God's blessing upon her. Wives for husbands, husband for wives. It is a real healing thing to hear your spouse praying for you and praying blessings upon you.
Yes.
It goes on to say in verse 10, for the scripture says, and again, I'm in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 10. For the scripture says, if you want to enjoy life and see many happy days, keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn away from evil and do good. Search for peace and work to maintain it. For the eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the Lord turns his face against those who do evil. Now, I hope you see why I decided to include these verses in our marriage text, because it absolutely does apply to marriage. It applies to every relationship, but especially marriage. You want to enjoy life? You want to have a good marriage? And it says, you want to enjoy life and see many happy days? Keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. Okay, there's two things. Watch what you say to one another.
Yes.
Don't be insulting, accusing, or I've heard husbands and wives swear at each other, call each other foul names. It's just like, what in the world are you doing? You're shooting yourself in the foot, brother. You know, when you think you're all macho man and you cuss out your wife and call her words that are disrespectful, you're shooting yourself in the foot. You need to be building that woman up and letting her know that, you know, I'm not the enemy. The enemy is the enemy. We're on each other's team, you know.
Yes.
So you want to enjoy life and see many happy days. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. There's another thing. I've seen many marriages ruined because they couldn't trust one another because the husband or wife kept catching the other in a lie, lie after lie after lie. Now, I'm the first to admit that you don't have to fully be able to trust somebody in order to love them. You could love somebody even though you know you can't trust them, but it gets harder and harder and harder, okay? Marriage is built upon love, not just trust. There are times when you know, your trust has been broken. You need to restore that trust, and trust can only be restored from long-term, repeated reliability demonstrated, okay? But I think you need to make love the focus, but I'm just telling you right now, it says here in any relationship, if you want to have a good life and have happy days, then don't tell lies. You are destroying that relationship, which, remember, we were talking about marriage is intended to be a relationship of love and safety, where both the husband and wife reflect Christ's love and glory. Well, that's not the case if you can't trust one another. And that's not the case if you continue to catch one another telling lies. So keep that in mind.
I know you all have heard it. Once those words go out, you can't take them back again. And I've seen people with the excuse, with they are foul, like you said, cuss their wife out, whatever. And then, oh, I'm sorry. Well, that don't make up for it. Just saying you're sorry doesn't make up for it. Our goal needs to be, don't do that in the first place.
Right.
You shouldn't do that to anybody. But you especially should not do that to your spouse.
Right.
Okay, that's your flesh That's you.
Right.
That's part of you. You shouldn't treat them that way. But nobody, as a Christian especially, you should not be treating anybody that way. Because it goes back to where we started today. That without a word, she could win mm-hmm. her husband over, who's mm-hmm. not a believer, by her conduct. By the way she acts, he sees Christ in her. Well, that's how we should be to the world. The world should be able to see Christ in us so that they can say, wait a minute. And they're looking at us, taking a double take. What's different about you? Wait, you should have got mad at me. You should have just yelled at me. You should have just cussed me out. You should have done this, that, whatever retaliation. But instead, they've seen the love of Christ in you. Mm-hmm. So it isn't just to our spouse. It's to everybody. Christian. This is Christian living.
Yep.
This is how we are supposed to be. The Lord wants us to be holy. Right?
That's, how much more in marriage?
Yeah,
right?
How much more in marriage?
Okay, now look at verse 11. This is powerful. Verse 11 says, turn away from evil and do good. Search for peace and work to maintain it. Something I always like to point out to people is God never just tells you don't do something. You know, if he tells you, I think it's in Romans 12, it says, don't steal. But then he says, but instead work with your hands so that you can have something to give to those in need. And so quite often when you read in the scriptures what not to do, God will give you a good habit to replace your bad habits. Okay. And so he says, turn away from evil and do good. Don't just turn away from evil. Guys, we need to keep ourselves busy, right? And, you know, reminds me of there's an old saying that says, idle hands are the devil's workshop. And what it means is if you're not really doing anything with your life, if you're just looking for stuff to do and you're bored, you'll probably get yourself into some trouble by doing things you shouldn't do. So the best remedy for that is keep yourself busy serving the Lord. And one of the things Linda and I have learned together over the years is to keep our marriage healthy is that we serve the Lord together.
We do good together.
We turn away from evil and we do good together. And so what that means, it means a number of things. It means that we can actually get in ministry together. It means there's times when we see somebody, whether we're out and about or whether somebody in the church that we realize needs help. By the way, music, and I think it's time to stop here. Listen, turn away from evil, do good. Read the rest of this. Verse 12 is awesome. Maybe we'll just kind of pick up on that tomorrow, and then we'll move on to the next point. Lord bless you guys. I hope you're able to hang in here for a full hour with us. We'll see you tomorrow.
If you'd like to know more about Calvary Chapel of Eagle, just go to the website at cceagle.org. Be sure and join Pastor Mike every Saturday at 8 p.m. and on Sundays at 8 a.m. for his radio show, It's All About Jesus. If we ran out of time and you didn't get a chance to call in, you can send your questions to lookup at cceagle.org. And may the Lord richly bless you as you continue to look up to Jesus.
Look full in his wonderful face. I want to grow dim, standing next to him.
Jesus breaks down the walls.